To check in with the president of Gearbox Software, Randy Pitchford. Randy,
how's it
always
going?
Dressed so nice.
Thanks, man.
We don't know where you get your shirts, but they're all.
You know, my wife dresses me.
Christy's back in the room. They got it all lined up for the week, right?
That's right. Check it out. This one's got Space Invaders on it.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that wild? Like, I don't know where.
I don't know if that'll show up on camera, but you're right. It's like, yeah.
There's Space Invaders on the shirt.
Well, you've been doing so much for the video game industry for so many years, and we want
to have you. So have you.
Thank you. But it's, we're excited to have you here. We're psyched that you're going to be on the panel tomorrow with Neil deGrasse
Tyson. Oh, that's going to be a blast.
Hardwick, James Gunn, talking about how you build these worlds. And I love that you're here just to kind of chat, because it's not like there's some, you know, massive new Gearbox, you know, reveal.
Well, I got lots of things I can sell you. But, like, this is E3, and it's exactly. Awesome, and there's so much cool stuff going on. So
yeah.
It's fun to kind of take high level, too, and just
that's
look at the industry.
Exactly. We all love games, and, you know, you guys certainly are working on a lot of great stuff. I would be remiss if I didn't ask you about Borderlands, because we saw, I think it was at GDC, you guys teased a little bit of the game engine, how you're working with Unreal Engine.
Yeah, that was a tech talk about some of the technology we're working on.
Early, obviously, but what can you tell us? I mean, you guys have been pretty open, I think, you know, at panels and stuff. You know, we're trying to recruit people to work on Borderlands. It's not a secret that that's your next big project, right?
I can tell you, obviously, we're very, very excited about what we're working on. I know there's a lot of people that love the Borderlands franchise, and they're really looking forward to more from us.
Yeah.
And I can't wait. Like, there will be a big official announcement.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's really important, I think. And one of the things I'm actually really happy about with Take-Two and 2K as a partner is we've really come into alignment that we should really have everything that we want to talk about ready to go,
right,
and know exactly where we are, yep, and have the evidence to prove it all before we, you know, showboat and make some big announcements. I think it's really important that expectations are set correctly. Mm-hmm. We have some incredible ambitions with the game. And so when that big announcement happens, we'll have everything all lined up and we know exactly what we'll be delivering.
All right. Not this E3 though, right?
No, unfortunately. I know there's so many people
holding out for that PlayStation announcement tonight or something. Yeah.
I know there's a lot of people looking forward to us talking about it. And, and people do know we're working on it, and we are. In fact, most of the developers at Gearbox, this is what we're doing.
Oh, wow.
So it's all I think about.
It's a big property. Let's talk about Borderlands kind of as a property.
Yeah.
Where is, you know, there's always been tales from the Borderlands.
Yes.
The things that have happened. Are you guys thinking now about sort of where Borderlands can go into different mediums?
Well, I'll tell you, one thing that's been really interesting is as Borderlands has been successful, a lot of folks wanted to get involved with us, and that's how projects like Tales from the Borderlands happened. I think one of the things I'm most excited about, but there's tons of stuff, and it would take like the rest of the afternoon to go over every little thing going on. But I think the biggest thing that we're most excited about is the movie in development.
You know,
Lionsgate is the studio, and Arad Productions is the production company. And I don't know if you know Arad Productions, but you know, Avi Arad ran Marvel Studios.
Yep.
You know, they created the Spider-Man film, X-Men, Iron Man, and kind of figured out how to finally make really good, entertaining comic book movies.
Yep.
And so these are the guys that are behind figuring out how to finally make a good video game movie.
Yeah.
And they think Borderlands might help them do it. So it's been a fun process, and I've learned a lot. You know, I've done a couple other things in the past. We did a television documentary with the Brothers in Arms series on the History Channel, but this is a whole different level, you know, and it's
you
not.
You know, where is the movie going to be sort of just set in the world, and Pandora, is it going to be on sort of like, you know, around the first game, or how's it going
to be? I'll talk about it a little bit. I mean, obviously nothing's been officially announced yet, but we've been developing scripts, and the strategy that we're on right now is that it's obviously all in the Borderlands universe, but rather than retell the stories that were in the game, we'll create new stories. So the films will have like their own almost, you know, film canon. We'll use all the characters and all the scenarios, of course.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like a similar strategy to what Marvel's doing, where you can't read any particular film plot in a comic book, but there's a lot of the characters, themes, and in fact, some of the situations are represented. And it's very important to take that strategy, because the 90 to, you know, 120 minute passive, you know, entertainment medium that's film is completely different than the way we consume story and characters in the video game.
Yep.
So it's really important to respect that and develop a story that's designed, designed for the film medium. But holy crap, it's been a blast. And I just can't believe how behind it Lionsgate is. Like, these guys are these guys are pumped, and they're like the real deal. That's awesome. We'll see, man. I mean, I'll be honest, there have not been a lot of great video game films. In fact, most of them kind of suck.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like the EV, but you know, the expected value is, we'll see, but I think there's a shot.
And you can give it time, see what happens, and you're still going to focus on, you know, making
Yeah, well, that's
game.
That's what's great about it, is if there's a great film that happens, like, it obviously helps and everybody will get to enjoy it, but it doesn't change anything that we're doing in the video game space. If anything, it just kind of adds this extra layer of excitement, which pumps us up a bit.
Now all we need is the Duke Nukem movie, right?
Yeah,
make
right?
it happen.
We're working on that.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I can't announce it, but there's been a whole, you'd be surprised. It's blown my mind. There's been a lot of production companies that have come at us, and we are putting a deal right now together with a major motion picture studio and a I'll tell you off the record if you want to know, but it's holy crap, it's the exact right people that should be doing a Duke Nukem film, and you know, we'll see what happens, but it's unbelievable. That's I think that's very likely to be a thing.
Are you gonna make more Duke games, do you think?
Yeah, there's a couple things going on. Well, one of the most the cool things is, you know, the games are great, but some people know this. Duke Nukem's actually gonna be making a cameo in Steven Spielberg's upcoming Ready Player One film.
Oh, really?
That's coming later this summer. Okay. Yeah, do you know about the film?
Of course I know.
Have you
the
read
film.
The book?
Yeah, yeah.
So no, Ernie Cline's book is amazing. Yeah. If you haven't read Ready Player One.
I didn't know that Duke's going to be in.
Yeah, he's making I may have just scooped that, but and it's pretty cool. Yeah, he's because you know the game, the story. A lot of the story takes place on the Oasis.
Yeah,
and people take on avatars of just who they wish they can be, and apparently there's a few cool, you know, video game cameos, but it's not a big role, but he's going to show up and. He's going to be Duke, man.
We missed the Duke.
Yeah.
What about Brothers in Arms? Do you guys ever go back to that? Do you think it's like you were talking about maybe doing another one?
We do. In fact, we've had in development for some time. Again, it's not ready to make the big announcement, but we have had in development for some time a new Brothers in Arms game. It's authentic. It's got Sergeant Baker. It is the Brothers in Arms game that we want to make.
Uh-huh.
And we're doing it under our publishing label.
Okay.
So what's great about this?
You guys have now.
That's right.
Like we had you at the Game Awards. You
and
you I
was really grateful when Ubisoft jumped in to help publish the original Brothers in Arms games. But as that relationship matured, you know, I think for them they just thought the game looked pretty cool and it was sort of a side bet, and it turned out to be a big franchise and it became important to their business. And as that was true, then they got more and more involved.
Yeah.
And I think their interests with it were different from where we think Brothers in Arms is.
Yeah.
And so now
you have it, it's your
IP. We own the IP, but we worked that out so that, you know, it's all free and clear with Gearbox, and now we can do the authentic game that Brothers in Arms fans really want.
Okay.
And we haven't gotten to the point where we really are ready to announce it, but I think Brothers in Arms has always been strong because of its unique kind of tactical gameplay. It's not just a raw shooter. There's a lot more to it than just the skill test. But there's also a storytelling element, and that's, we're really pushing that to new places. And our experience working with Telltale on the Tales series has taught us that you can actually make gameplay out of storytelling, and you can have that be really engaging. In fact, I think in the Telltale games, the best parts of those games are interacting with the storytelling and not anything that resembles a skill test.
Yep, yeah, that's interesting. All right, so that's actively in development.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's awesome. Well, Gearbox Publishing, that's exciting to see you guys. You know, you've always been, I always admire how independent you've always been.
Yeah,
a lot of bigger developers.
It's challenging,
that have a couple hits and then they sell to the publisher. And you're, I think, probably one of the largest sort of independent.
It's weird. We're like, feel like a last man standing in that regard. Like,
but I think you've held out. I'm sure you had many offers over the years to go join companies.
Every partner we've ever worked with, that's usually the first and last conversation.
Right.
And several conversations in between.
But I admire that you've sort of held out, be independent. Just like I like to keep Game Awards independent. It's like you get to sort of, you know, do your thing. And now you get to, you know, because of digital distribution, you can put these games out yourself.
Yeah,
you it's
really opened up a lot of things, and not only for our own titles, but also helping other third parties. You know, like we helped People Can Fly get Bulletstorm out there, and it was just announced that Gearbox is the retail publisher for Epic's next game, Fortnite.
Exactly.
Like, holy crap, Gearbox is publishing helping Epic. Like,
it's amazing.
Epic's, you know.
You license the engine now.
I know, right? It's just, like, it's unbelievable that's happening. But one of the reasons I think that that's happening is because we are a developer.
Yeah.
So we kind of get what that's like to be a developer. And our business deals with developers are extraordinary.
Yeah.
Like, crazily developer-friendly. Epic could not find another publisher that would do what we're willing to do for Epic.
Happy to do it.
And we know we want the same thing because we are fiercely independent, and we just need what we need for our properties.
Well, it's very cool, and it's great to have you here at E3 just to hang out, talk about games.
Yeah, man.
I'm sure in future years we'll have much more to show gameplay-wise.
Oh, yeah. There's, you know, if you want, there's some other things, too, with publishing.
Yeah.
Because we are able to do our own titles and able to do some third-party titles. One of the fun new things that I've been working on is a VR project with Penn and Teller. Do you know those guys?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Well, I've seen you. You're good buddies with them.
Yeah. So I used to be a magician before I became a game developer. And I've always, like, in the back of my mind, like, how do we use magic for video games? And I've never really been able to do that directly. Like, a lot of the things I've learned and techniques I've been able to kind of draw upon for video games, but I've never directly done a magic trick in a video game before. And with this Penn and Teller project, we're doing it. And holy crap, with VR, it's absolutely perfect. You can really,
You
can really mess with people.
Okay.
And because they can't see anything out in the world. And there's all these expectations that you draw. For example, when you have the controllers in your hand and you see the controllers in VR, you make this association between that object and the real world and the object you're seeing in VR. But we can disambiguate that. Like, imagine if the operator's holding a controller, you see the controller and you think that's where they're standing because you can see the controller and the body attached. But they don't have to be standing there.
Yeah.
In fact, that controller doesn't actually have to be that controller. Even though you see it in VR, that controller could be anywhere. And there's all kinds of fun things we can do to just absolutely, and Penn and Teller are just absolute geniuses for taking what the expectations are and turning them upside down to just rip our brains apart. And the idea of just absolutely messing with people is a lot of fun too. So it's going to be called Penn and Teller's Cruel Virtual Tricks for Real Friends. And there's a whole set of bits, some you can enjoy on your own, some where you can mess with other people. And if you've ever, like, I don't know if you've ever done a practical joke on someone or played a prank or...
Maybe back in the day.
So with these VR tricks, like, what happens is when we do the really bad ones, like the really horrible shit that you really shouldn't do, people come out of it, you know, okay, that was immoral, that was unethical, you're an asshole, you should not have done it, let's go do it to somebody else. And that's like...
Pay it forward.
Yeah, it's really a lot
of
fun.
All right, well, we can't wait to see that. So much going on at Gearbox, Randy.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for stopping
by. Awesome hanging out. Have a good show, man. We'll see you tomorrow.
We'll see you tomorrow for the big panel, but right now we are going to